Thank you very much, Ben, for that very nice introduction. And I tell people that if you're here today and you want someone to blame, you can blame my wife. In July of last year, we were passing through London on the way home from a cruise, and my wife had theater tickets and I didn't, and she said, not wanting me to be left without anything to do, she said, there's a nice talk going on at the Hausman bookstore that you might be interested in. Why don't you go do that? And she was off to see Richard III with Kevin Spacey, and I went to hear Ben talk. And it was such a it was a great experience. I'm a person who believes that there are no such thing as coincidences. I believe that I was destined to meet that night with Ben and talk about Veterans for Peace, and we were destined here because we have a job to do in this world that desperately needs the struggle for peace. If I could begin by just telling you an incident that I'll remember for a long time that happened to me just this past Saturday, when I was coming to a meeting here, introductory meeting about the Bradley Manning event. And I got off of the tube stop at Manor House, and I didn't have any idea where Marston Street was. So I asked somebody, and they pointed me in the wrong direction. So I spent 20 minutes walking the opposite direction from here. And I was beginning worried as I looked at my clock that I wasn't going to be able to get back here in time for the meeting. I saw a gentleman leaning against a post by the bus stop, and I went up to him and I showed him this address and I said, can you help me find this address? And he looked and he immediately got out his cell phone and he punched in on his map where this was located. He said, well, you're in the opposite direction. You need to go back about another half hour walk. But he said, better than that, why don't you wait here on the bus, and you have a bus pass? And I did. And he said, hop on the bus with me and I will take you partway there and I'll explain to you how to get there. So I hopped on the bus. We made the short trip back up to the Marston Tube Station, or the Manor House Tube Station, I guess it is. And as we were walking off the bus, and I thanked him for helping me, and he turned to me and he said, you speak English. He says, you're not from here though, are you? I said, no, I'm not. I'm actually from California in the States. And he goes, and I had my jacket on there with the Veterans for Peace emblem. And he said, well, are you in the military? What is this that you have here? And I could tell from the accent that he was probably from the Middle East, and very, very fine person, very kind person to me. And I said, yes, I was in the military. I'm not now, but I'm here as a member of Veterans for Peace. I'm going to a meeting with helping to get organized a Veterans for Peace chapter here in London. And he said to me, Veterans for Peace, he said, he looked back at me, he said, do you mean that there are actually people in the United States that are working for peace? And I said, I said, yes, there are. And he stepped back, he says, you know, I'm a Muslim. And he hit his head like this. He says, why does everybody put a stamp on my head that I want to kill people? He said, I would not, my religion would not permit me to harm you in any way, to harm a piece of hair on your head, nor would I be permitted. He was trying to search for another example. He said, would I be permitted to scratch your face or to draw blood from you? He says, that's not my religion. I believe in peace. And he kind of looked around at the sky and around. He says, why can't we live in peace? And I said, that's what I want to do. That's what Veterans for Peace wants to do in the United States. That's what we veterans in the United States are working for. And that's what a group of veterans in the United Kingdom are going to be working for. And then he said, well, there's your bus stop. And I turned around, I shook hands with him again. And as we parted, he turned and looked at me, and again, he said, meeting you today has put a spirit in me. He says, for a moment today, I feel like there's hope in my heart. And I walked away to the bus, and I got on the bus, and I thought, here I am, and probably the total time that I was in his presence was 10 or 12 minutes, maybe. And yet, here's a man from a culture that's entirely different than mine, a religion entirely different from mine. I was raised in the Catholic Church. This is a man who is a professed Muslim, and we both had one common ground, and that is that we need to work for peace, and why can't we find peace in this world? And it made me feel encouraged coming down here. Every once in a while, you need that inspiration that what you're doing is positive, that you can have a positive impact. And even if you're talking one-on-one, to me, that was a very positive moment that I will not long for, I will long remember. And I think it helps me to understand this concept of peace and war. And I want to just introduce a little bit about what I think the struggle is in our culture in the United States. I can't speak for what how you look at it here, but the notion of war and peace is so intertwined in the U.S. historically that it's hard to separate them out. People in the U.S. almost invariably tie war and peace as if they're the same idea and concept. And let me give you an idea from our history about how that may come about. You know, the Americans have a great love for guns, right? We prove it day in and day out. But back in 1872, there was a man, and probably you may know about this, there's a man who was an inventor named Samuel Colt. Samuel Colt manufactured and designed the Colt 45 pistol. The Colt 45 pistol from 1872 to about 1895 was the official sidearm of the U.S. Army. And it was also the weapon that was used by those great frontiersmen that was taming the wild American West, people like Bat Masterson and Wyatt Earp, the gunslingers of the Old West. And you wonder how many of these weapons, how many of these guns, during that period of time, in the last part of that century, the United States was expanding out west, and we were engaged in many of the Indian wars against our Native Americans, the Sioux and the Apache and the Cherokee and the Arapaho and all of those Indian tribes. And you wonder, in the great battle of the Little Bighorn River of General Custer, you wonder how many people were killed by the use of the Colt 45. And of course, the Colt 45 had a nickname. Do you remember? Anybody recall what that was? It was called the Peacemaker, right? Isn't that interesting? A weapon used to kill is called a peacemaker. But the Army thought that that was such a great idea that when they developed the Nike missile back in the 50s and 60s, they also named it the Peacemaker. But the United States Air Force was not to be outdone. The United States Air Force Strategic Air Command, with its fleet of 5,000 planes, and one-third of their planes during the Cold War were flying close to the border of China and Russia, ready to drop bombs to obliterate that part of the world, and would have, in essence, would have obliterated all of us eventually. But the Strategic Air Command decided that what they needed as their motto was that peace is our profession. So you see how we use that term, peace, tied into war, and it's no wonder that people can't separate out what it really means to have true peace. It's also in literature. Some of you may have read the famous George Orwell's book. He wrote it in 1948 and then flipped the digits around and called the book 1984. Well, if you remember reading in the book, there was the Ministry of Truth. Remember that Ministry of Truth, Mini Truth? And on the facade of the Ministry of Truth was the slogan, "War is peace." War is peace. And an anomaly about how we think about war and peace in this country. So it seems to me that we have a tough job to constantly struggle against the notion that there has to be a tie-up, that you can't have peace unless there's war, that weapons are going to be the vehicle by which you will live a peaceful and happy and prosperous life. That notion is something that we have to fight against. That is the militarization, or the militarism that we are seeing in the United States. Militarism, you know, is a philosophy. It's an ideology. It's one of the isms. Militarism in the United States, it means militarism, that a nation develops a dominant and powerful military as an extension of its foreign policy. And because of militarism, then you develop the corollary to that. How do you get to be how do you fulfill the doctrine of militarism? It's through militarization. Militarization is the process by which the military-industrial complex would develop all of this to create the possibility of having militarism as a philosophy of our society. So Veterans for Peace started 25 years ago, when I believe it was, and Gerry may know this more accurately than I do, but I believe that it was a couple of veterans, a Vietnam veteran and a Korean War veteran, that sat down in the mid-1980s and said, you know, we got to do something about this. Maybe there's something that veterans can say about war. And I think they scratched out on a napkin some ideas about the mission statement that we all adhere to, of about a nonviolent approach. Our belief is that we have five purposes or five goals. One is that our collective experience as veterans tells us that wars are an easy thing to get involved in. It's difficult to extract yourself from the war. The consequences are grave. War is nothing but chaos and devastation, not only to the nation that you're there, but ultimately to the people who perpetrate the war itself. No matter what part of the war machine cog that you're involved in, you suffer from the consequences of being involved in the acts of violence of others, and even if you're not the perpetrator yourself. So, Veterans for Peace got underway. I learned about it in the 2000s after the Iraq War, and being a veteran that was that came to the notion after I left Vietnam, after the third time my ship was there, I decided flying home in a C-141 Starlifter jet with about 250 caskets of American servicemen and women who were going to go home for their final resting place. And I was with five people sitting on this plane flying home, and I was going to be surviving. I was going to another duty station for a couple of years, but I decided then that I needed to do something with the rest of my life that would struggle against the military-industrial complex, study against war and violence. And when I found Veterans for Peace, I said, this is a fit for me, because I think what Veterans for Peace does, and I think Ben and his group will find this as they go through society, is that when people listen to you or see that you're a veteran for peace, they will give you the benefit of having it'll get your foot in the door. You're not automatically dismissed as some crazy peacenik out here. All these people, what do they know? But when you're a veteran, they'll say, this person speaks with some degree of authority, at least will listen to what they have to say. And that's been my experience, and I'm sure Gerry's experience has been very similar to that. So we're fortunate in that we get an audience. And what we try to do in San Diego is to follow the mission statement, and that is what is the true cost of war? To make the public aware of the true cost of war is the first goal. Secondly, is to implore our country to do what we can to keep it from involved in the internal or external affairs of other nations. Three, end the arms race and eliminate nuclear weapons. Four, seek justice for veterans and victims of war. And five, eliminate war as an instrument of national policy. And we do this through nonviolent means, and we join with other like-minded people who want to join in that effort to find a way to peace. So that's what we try to do. A few things in San Diego that we do, we talk, as I'm doing today, to a lot of civic groups, to a lot of public members, to political groups, to student groups, to high schools, to colleges. We have film forums where we sponsor films about war, and then we have groups of veterans talk about the impact, what that film means to them, how it applies to their life, and what you can do in your community to end militarism, end war. We have an Arlington West feature, which we call, and you didn't have a chance to see, some of you saw the film, but we began this process of on Memorial Day generally, and early when I joined it, we did it almost every week in Camp Pendleton, was to put out crosses of all that represents every U.S. serviceman and woman that was killed in Iraq. And when we got to 2,500 crosses, our truck that we carried, we couldn't carry anymore, so we just stopped making them. And we would put them out and have them represent the number of people that were killed in the war. And that was our statement of reminding people not only of the cost of war. And some people may say, well, you're honoring the people. Is this an honoring of war? And we said, no. You know, people in the military go there sometimes with good motivation and good understanding. I know when I went in with the belief that what I was doing was the right thing. And I think you hear other veterans tell you the same thing. But what we find out is that maybe we look at these people that died in the war and we honor the service. And the duty that they did is they understood it. They understood a certain amount of duty that they have, so we honor that. But that doesn't mean we support the war. And so that memorial that we do gained a tremendous amount of publicity in San Diego. We would have the news, the television stations, the news cameras come out there time and time again and show it on the evening news of what we were doing. Another program that we have is to help veterans. You know, in the United States, 9% of the population are veterans. The homeless living in the streets of the United States, veterans amount to 33% of the people living in the street. In San Diego, California, one of the great cities and beautiful parts of the world, we have about 3,000 veterans living on the street homeless. So what we decided to do is to try to find a campaign, something that we could do to help them. So we called it the Campaign for Compassion. And what we did is we decided that we could provide sleeping bags and rain ponchos during the winter months when it was chilly to help those people survive on the street. And we thought we'd start with a modest program. So we asked the people that we knew through our website and through our email to help us and ask for donations. And we had a modest goal. We thought if we could raise $3,000, we could get about 100 sleeping bags and ponchos and then deliver those to the homeless. Well, in the last little over a year, we've raised over $30,000. We've delivered over 1,200 sleeping bags and rain ponchos to veterans living on the streets of San Diego. And not only veterans, but we won't turn down homeless people who need a sleeping bag, because in our mind, the homeless are victims of war every bit as much as some of the veterans are. Those people are on the streets because we've taken money out of our society and diverted it to the war machine. And now we don't have the ability to create jobs, or we don't have the ability to send money to schools or prepare our infrastructure or to provide medical care and home care. And so when we talk to people about the cost of war, you know, it's very easy to chalk it up to the numbers. Well, there were so many killed, so many wounded. That's a tough cost of war. But you have to look deep into the cost of war. How does it affect the communities? And I can take you a website that we have where I can break down every congressional district in the United States. I can tell you how much money is being spent from those taxpayers on war and what the alternatives they could get back from it if it wasn't for the military use of that money. For example, and I'll just close here because I've talked a little bit of time here, but let me just give you a quick example of this. You know, one of the big budget crises in all of the states, the state governments in the United States are having very difficult budget times, as well as the federal government. In the state that I live in, California, our budget in the past year amounted to about $25 billion, $25 billion. In the 10 years since the Iraq War began in Afghanistan, the taxpayers of California, their proportionate share of their federal tax dollars that go to fund the war in Afghanistan and Iraq, not the military budget that we have, I'm excluding the military budget, which is this year $700+ billion, not counting the billions that we spend in the Department of Energy, which handles the nuclear weapons area, not the Homeland Security, not the Veterans Administration that takes care of veterans, and the billions that it costs for that. I'm talking about $700 billion for the budget for the military. Now let's shift over to the war. That's not even part of that. $1 or $2 trillion that we've spent on that. But in California, in the last 10 years, with a budget of $25 billion, the taxpayers of California funded the war to the tune of $150 billion, have been diverted to fight these wars. So the government will tell us, we don't have any money for schools, for health care, to rebuild the infrastructure, to provide for the benefit of the people, education, and so on. Well, they do, but the money is gone to fund these unfunded, unnecessary, illegal, unjustified wars. That's where the money is going. So you dig deep into these issues and let the people know so that they can buy into the idea that it's not just them out there that's being affected. It's not just the soldiers who are dying. It's not just the loss of life and the injured and maimed that are coming back, and the 300,000 with post-traumatic stress disorder, and the double the suicide rate of American servicemen and women, particularly males, which is double the national average suicide for returning veterans. But those costs are obvious. But when you bring it home and make people understand and realize that every bit of the military budget, every bit of what happens in war affects them personally, that it is taking away from the society as a whole, then you can get them to understand, to listen to you, and to help you mobilize and fight against war. That's what we hope to do. I'm so proud to be here. I'm proud of what Ben Griffin has done. I'm thankful that my wife sent me to that bookstore to meet Ben. And I hope that, and I can tell you to Ben and to all of the veterans here that every time that you go and represent Veterans for Peace and you stand up against war and you are there and you may feel as though you're alone, take a look behind you. You won't see us there in physically, but we will in spirit. Your brothers and sisters in Veterans for Peace in the United States will be standing with you. So thank you, and I hope that you will continue to support Veterans for Peace here in the United Kingdom.